Well, welcome to church. You're going to get kind of two messages today. I believe God has something on our heart. And, we live very busy lives, don't we? We got to get to the kids to soccer practice and basketball practice and football practice and mom's coming to town. And there's lots of things going on all the time. And God is always talking and God is always moving. And just because sometimes you feel detached or kind of dead doesn't mean that God is dead or detached. God's always moving. And I believe God always wants to speak, and we always need to be in a place of listening. And so today we're going to speak kind of on that, along those lines. Open up your Bibles to, let's go to Psalms 46. Psalms 46, verse 10, it says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. And the Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Be still and know that I am God." Another version, it says, "Desist." Just like stop everything. "And know that I am God. I am exalted among the nations." Another version, this is in the Message version, it says, "Step out of traffic." Isn't that good? Like, stop just doing everything that we do. I think we've become so busy sometimes being still in the presence of God. I don't know about you, but sometimes I'm like, I'm too busy for that. And today is on my heart that we would redeem the time, that we would be paying attention to how we spend our time, making sure that we're going to be the most effective with our time here on earth, because our life is but a vapor. Let's pray. Let's believe God for the message. Father, we thank you for today. Lord, I pray that you'd help me speak. I pray that you'd help the congregation engage and listen. I pray, like the Ephesians prayer, Lord, that our eyes would be open, that none of us would be walking in short-sightedness, but all of us would be attentive to your word. And Lord, that as your word comes forth, we would understand. And I don't ask, Father, for just information. God, I ask for revelation today. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Don't you love church that we get to come together and hang out? And I always think as a preacher, you know, it's fun. I like preaching under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Like, I've preached other ways before. And to be absolutely honest with you, it's most fun when God is here and present. And that oftentimes has a lot to do with the people, and has a lot to do with, obviously, the preacher has a job, but the people have a job. And God used a donkey in the Old Testament to speak to a prophet, and so surely he could use me to kind of help us today. And so I think we have a specific message and a specific time for this day and age. And so, have you ever wasted time? Somebody's like, "I'm doing it right now." No. Have you ever wasted time? Have you ever, I ever in the morning sometimes I'll wake up and you got that groggy wake up and you kind of like grab your phone and you're like Facebook and you're like Instagram, and maybe only me, but I just do that. And then you're like, "Oh, I got to get going." And you're like Facebook and Instagram, and then it's like been 20 minutes and you're like, "Man, that was way too long." Facebook, Instagram, and you're like, "Oh my gosh, I've like wasted time." I looked up some statistics for us, and just in case you weren't going to be honest, it says the average American spends 2 hours on social media. And the average American has 5 social media accounts. That's YouTube, Tumblr, Instagram, Snapchat, all of them. Pinterest, ladies, hey. We spend a lot of time on social media. And unfortunately, we have not stopped our time on our television either. The average American is 4 to 5 hours a day. Now, honestly, maybe I'm super spiritual. I'm not there yet, but that's a long time on TV, and that's the average people. We spend a lot of time, and that's actually if you're older than the age of 2. Most people, our kids, are engaging in this all the time. And if we're not careful, this is kind of our life, you know? And just for the fun of it, we spend 53 hours a year on average at the grocery store. Ladies, you spend 1 minute more than the average man. That's actually really a statistic. So we spend, maybe you go down one extra aisle. I don't know. Because average time spent is 52 minutes every grocery store visit. So we spend time doing stuff. And this is, I actually even Googled, we spend time on in traffic, like 43 hours a year in traffic. Like, and ladies, you'll spend 3 months or 3 to 6 months out of your whole life doing laundry, right? Some of you are like, I did that last year. So we spend a lot of time doing stuff. And like, I don't know about you, but it seems like our days are getting shorter and shorter and time is getting, and we just keep moving. I am one of those that I like to move. Like I don't like sitting down. I just feel like, we have a new couch. I haven't really used it too much. Usually there's a time in my life where it's usually around November. I finish up with wedding photography some and I sit around and I play an Xbox game. I know that sounds wrong. I'm sorry, it's truth. And so I'll spend like 2 weeks just I don't really move and I play Xbox and that's kind of my life for a little bit. I didn't do it this year, but we waste a lot of time. And these days we get busier and busier and busier. And if we make a plan, we like, yeah, let's. If there's maybe an empty schedule, we say, hey, let's go fill it up. And I don't know about you, but now because of social media. It used to be like, I don't know about the pumpkin patches. Was a pumpkin patch a thing long ago? Now it's a thing because we see our friends. They went to the pumpkin patch. Now we need to go to the pumpkin patch. And we got to get pictures with our kids in the pumpkin patch. And if we don't get pictures with the kids in the pumpkin patch, we are bad parents. And so, and then we're like, oh, you went to the zoo lights? Now we got to go to the zoo lights. Okay, so everybody gets to the zoo lights. And then we went to the zoo lights. Oh, you went to summer vacation? Now I need to go to summer vacation. You went to Great Wolf Lodge? I need to go to Great Wolf. And so we fill up our time. And the Bible says in Psalms 46, be still. Get out of traffic. And know that I am God. And I don't think, for some reason, I think our prayer times and our time with God becomes less and less important. And listen to me very closely. Some of us, we listen to our Bible reading just because we listen to it, and we can't take the time and sit and read the Bible. We're like, yeah, I'll just listen to it. And I've done that even myself, that should be an addition to your devotional time, not your main devotional time. I believe in praying while you drive. I believe in praying while you're on the move. But that should be an addition to your prayer times, not the prayer time. With like oatmeal in your mouth, painting your nails, and driving all at the same time. Texting, driving, oatmeal, and praying in tongues. Like hopefully our life, we can slow it down to listen to God. And so we've been talking about trying to get out of our community. Really, the title, the series was Church with No Walls, right? Trying to, what's it like? How can we witness better? How can we invite our coworkers to work? How can we be a bigger light to the people around us? And so I started kind of preaching along those lines, and I had a fiery message that I was going to preach to you guys on like soul winning, and every one of you guys were going to be an evangelist by the end of the service, and it was going to be phenomenal. And God kind of moved on me a little bit towards this way. I feel like if we just go out, we even tell you right now, like, hey, go witness. You're like, okay, they said I should witness. Okay, so here I go. And like, you can go out and you can add witnessing to your busy schedule. And you're like, and that's where we get kind of harsh with people. That's where we get kind of like, you need to get to church or go to hell. Like, those are your options. Like, we're not witnessing with the help of the Holy Spirit because we haven't spent time with the Holy Spirit and hadn't got his influence and got his revelation and got his insight. And now we're trying to just go out and convert people, and they're not ready, you're not ready, but you got two unready people getting together. And it creates what it is. And then the church becomes a place of judgment. Church becomes like, they don't understand me and they don't have the right words to say. And we're doing things without the help of the Holy Spirit rather than the help of the Holy Spirit. So, and then, or there's another way we can witness, and that is like, well, whenever the Lord leads me. And he hasn't led you for years. I just think that's kind of strange. The God of the universe who cares so much about people, all of a sudden he hasn't interrupted you for years. And the truth is he's unable to because you're too busy. And I want to encourage us today. I don't want us discouraged. I want us at the end of this time to kind of fight for our prayer times, to kind of like, you know what, this is where I get my insight from. This is where I get my revelation from. This is where I get my inside information from. The Bible says it this way, go to your Father who is in the secret place, and when you've met with him, then he will reward you openly. And actually the Bible says that when he declares to you in secret, declare it openly. Shout it from the rooftops. And this is our times. We go to the throne, we get refreshing, we get filling, we get a passion for the things of God, and then we come out and we spill over into the world. If that is not our evangelism, it's going to be wrong. And it takes secret place. And guys, I believe today, even in this group, guys, there's secret prayer times that you've not yet experienced. There's places in the spirit through prayer that God will take you, and you'll come out smarter. You'll come out with more revelation. You'll come out, you're like, oh my goodness, I never saw that. I never saw that business plan. And you cannot get that through a self-help book. You know, self-help books are the number one selling books in America. We just want to self-help ourselves. And we read every self-help book, and it's a self-help book. It's going to be great. And guys, I think those are good and those are vital, but there is nothing like the Bible. There is nothing like the Bible with the help of the Holy Spirit that lets you see. But listen, that takes time. And sometimes we even try this. We're like, all right, I'm supposed to pray. Okay, I'm going to pray. I mean, we start praying, you're like, dude, I'm bored. Like, it's been like 10 minutes and I'm bored. So I'll try that again tomorrow. And then maybe some of us make it 3 days, maybe a day, you know, like it becomes like like we're trudging, and that should not be your prayer time. You got to get kind of over that. You got to get through the boring into the spiritual. And that's why I believe God is trying to take us. There is times of refreshing in the spirit that we are missing sometimes as a church. And when I say the church in general. And therefore, we're doing this all on our own, all in the flesh. You're living life. And listen, sometimes then the church becomes bogged down with the same addictions as the world. The same problems. We go through the same sicknesses. We are redeemed from it. We're supposed to be different. And somehow we're not, because we don't have the spiritual influence. Look at this. Let's read some scripture on the subject. This is Colossians 4. Question today is, when was the last time God interrupted your schedule? I remember a time I was getting ready for preaching in youth ministry, I was gonna go home and play Xbox, and I don't even play that much. Okay, by the way, my kids play more than I do, but I was gonna go home, and I think I got a game, and I was like, that was my plan. And I grabbed the door handle to my car, and the Spirit of God just kind of took a hold of me, and I began to cry and weep like a baby and I was like, what's going on? And so I get in my car and I start crying, and I begin to just pray for our young people. I think that should be normal. Man, I understand I'm a pastor, but guys, there's things in your business that need prayed for. There's things on your coworkers need prayed for. Like, there's your family members need prayer for, and you need to like witness with the help of the Holy Spirit, not just with your own intellect, not just with your own knowledge. Because how's that worked out for you? Some of your family members won't talk to you anymore. You know, it's like we might have done it wrong, you know, like, and we mean well. We wanna see the success that God has, but if we're gonna wanna see the success God has for us, we have to do it the way He's planned for us. And if you remember right, in Acts chapter 2 is the very first thing He says, before you go into all the world and preach the gospel, I need you to go get filled with the Holy Spirit. He says, first go to Acts chapter 2, get filled with the Holy Spirit, and then you can address the crowd. Why? Because we're a lot nicer when the Holy Spirit comes on us. We just are. Keep going. We're going somewhere. Colossians 4, verse 2, it says, devote yourselves to prayer. I wonder what he means by that. Maybe I look up the Hebrew in that. I'm being silly. Devote yourselves to prayer with an alert mind and a thankful heart. Colossians 4, chapter 2, it says, pray for us that God will give us many opportunities to speak his mysterious plan concerning Christ. That is why I'm here in chains. Pray that I'll proclaim this message as clearly as I should. Look at this, verse 5. Live wisely among those who are not unbelievers, or who are not believers. Make the most of every opportunity. Don't you love that? One version says, redeem the time. Do you know that we can not redeem the time? If he's telling you to make sure you make the most of opportunities, maybe you could blow some opportunities. We could miss some opportunities because we're too busy, because we've got too much stuff going on. I'm busy playing Candy Crush. We missed it. I remember one time I was 14 years old, and if you don't know my story, I grew up in church, and I really just, thanks be to God, I was here, you know what I mean? And at 14, I began to really pray and seek God, and that was when I really learned how to like pray, and like I was a weird kid, I prayed a lot. But I was so grateful for it because it made me more spiritual than carnal. And God just blessed me, and God was really speaking to me at like 14. I had plans to take over my school. What I mean by take over my school, I literally wanted to save everyone in my school. And like I was on my way to do it. Like, and then anyways, it was bizarre. I was a weird kid, okay? But God was talking to me, and God was really putting his anointing on my life, and he was teaching me some things. And I was in Kmart. We got 50 bucks for Christmas, and I got a chance to spend 50 bucks at Kmart. And we didn't even have Walmart. We had Kmart. And so we had Kmart, and I'm sitting there shopping, and I'm just minding my own business, and the Spirit of God spoke on the inside of my spirit. He said, lay your hands on that person. I walked by a guy with a wheelchair, and I was 14. This guy with a wheelchair, and he rolled by me. I just remember he rolled by me, and the Spirit of God said, lay your hands on him, and he'll walk. And I'm telling you, I got so scared as a kid. I freaked out. I was like, no, you got the wrong guy. And I ran out of that store scared. I really was. I was like, forget the 50 bucks. I don't get to spend. Nobody's getting any Christmas presents this year from me at all. And I was really scared. And it got to the point where I guess I got flushed and white scared. And my sister noticed. She says, what's wrong with you? I said, I think God told me to lay hands on that guy. And my sister, this is Kiara, my niece, it's her mom, said, go back in there. I was like, no, he's gone. I missed that opportunity. And I remember thinking like, man, I hope somebody, I mean, that's a big deal. I hope somebody prayed for that guy further down the road. What missed opportunities do you have? I went to Red Robin when I was 15. And thanks be to God, I believe I was there for many people. But one of the persons that is here is Kara Sunholm, Chris's wife, our video guy. And I bug her and I make jokes about her. I said, you are forever indebted to me because I brought you here and brought you your husband. You're welcome. So you're probably still a sinner if it wasn't for me. So you're welcome. But it was a coworker that we didn't miss an opportunity to share our faith in Jesus with. I've heard a story about Joe McGee tells a story about he had a boss, and this dude, whoever this boss was, I just keep telling this story, but he called each one of his workers into his office like they were in trouble. And so each worker, you know, scared, like, make sure, what's he calling me in for? And he's like, well, you're doing a good job. I hope all's well. Do you know the Lord Jesus Christ? And he would call each one, and he ended up getting most of the factory saved, and most of the factory ended up in ministry. It was like 15 people because this man had on his heart, I'm going to be a witness. Guys, you cannot spend time with God and keep walking by people and not caring about them. You cannot spend time with our Father and not get the Father's heart for people. If it's been years, and I'm not picking on anybody because most of us are in this boat. If it's been years since you led anyone to Christ, is Christ really alive in your heart? And I'm not picking on us. I don't want us to be like, oh, thanks. I came to church and now I feel bad. Appreciate it. But I believe that there's a right way to share our faith. I believe that God wants to empower you to do so. And that empowerment comes through time spent with him. And it's not like prayer, like a drudgery thing like I'm talking about. It's secret things. It's really fellowship. It's really the gospel. It's the good news that God wants to have fellowship with his people, and he has things to show you, and you're not that smart. I'm not that smart. God is smarter than us. And there's times in his word, and there's times in just simplicity of praying, and you can learn that here in this church, how to pray and how to pray effectively. But guys, honestly, there's something about just saying, all right, I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray. And the Bible tells us that if we seek him, we'll find him. If we knock, the door will be open. Oftentimes, we're just so busy, we're not even seeking. We're not even knocking. And we don't have enough time for it. Look at James chapter 4, verse 13. We make plans and we do things and we don't include God at all. We make plans and like, I'm going to go on vacation here this year, and I'm going to go do this, and I'm going to start this company, and I'm going to move to this city, and all of this is cool. But should we include God in our plans? Have we prayed about things that we think are really great ideas? I was going to do a window cleaning business. And it was a good idea, man. I call it shine window cleaning because I'm shining my light for Jesus and I'm cleaning your windows. And you're laughing. Some of you guys are laughing at me right now. Is it me doing manual labor? I don't know. And then I found out like how hard it is, Pastor Brian. You need like special equipment and like there's like guys who like, anyways. And I remember thinking like, well, that was a dumb idea. And there's a big difference between a good idea and a God idea. Listen, I don't want any young person, any old person in here just doing good ideas. You know, God ideas will save you from being swindled into like a multi-level marketing plan that went totally wrong. Like God ideas will keep you from being stupid with your money. So that's a free one. Okay, James chapter 4, verse 13 says, look here, you who say today or tomorrow we are going to a certain town, we'll stay there a year, we will do business there, make a profit. How do you know what your life will be like tomorrow? How will you know what your life will be like tomorrow? Your life is like a morning fog. It's here a little while, then gone. What you ought to say is if the Lord wants us to do, we will live here or there or do this or that. Otherwise, you are boasting about your own pretentious plans. Isn't the Bible kind? And all such boasting is evil. Remember, it is sin let's catch this. Remember, it is sin to know what you ought to do and then not do it. Some of you, God has been bothering you about things and you've been ignoring him. Some of you, God's told you to wake up at a certain time and pray and you've not yet got around to it. I want to encourage us today. It's time to listen to the Lord. It's time to be serious because eternity really depends on it. There's people that really depend on you being spiritual so that you can be the light that you're supposed to be in their life. But you can't be your own spiritual. You've got to be the person of the Holy Spirit spiritual. You've got to have a God plan. And there's some things in your life that might need changing, some thinking that might need changing, some vision that might need changing. You might see people a certain way, and God needs you to see them the way he wants you to see them. Ephesians 5, verse 16, it says, so be careful how you live. Don't live like fools. This is the Paul talking to the church in Ephesus. Potentially a church could live like fools, so this is not necessarily us, but we can maybe learn from it. It says, don't live like fools, live like those who are wise. Look at this, verse 16, 5, 16 says, make the most of every opportunity in these evil days. Another version says, redeem the time, pay attention to what you're doing. Let's not just waste time. It's not about making money, right? Keep going. It says, don't act thoughtlessly, but understand what the Lord wants us to do. Okay, I'm ready. What does the Lord want me to do? Don't be drunk with wine because it will ruin your life. Anybody ever experienced that? Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. What's our job? To be full of the Holy Spirit. We walk on the job and there's a presence that comes with us because we've spent time with our Father. There is a presence. Guys, this is the way we're supposed to live. And guys, I don't know about you, but have you ever felt carnal? You ever felt not spiritual? It's usually because we've missed those secret, special moments with our Father. They're a big deal. They're a big deal. And I hate to sometimes bring it back to like, hey, we got to read our Bibles and pray. But like, we got to read our Bibles and pray. And we can't do it like religiously. We got to do it because we love God and we want to see him move in our lives. And like, that's it. You either have the presence of the anointing of God, the tangible presence, or you don't. You either have a sweetness about your life because you've spent time with God, or you don't. And the world can tell. And if we're just trying to witness without that, we will have less fruit from it. Last scripture, it's Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10. Oh, we're going to read this. This is a quick story about Peter And Peter is in the Bible. Obviously, he was one of the apostles, and he loved the Lord, and he had done some things. Man, he walked on water. He addressed a crowd of 5,000. Then he went to church and healed a crippled man. And this Peter was on his way to being the man. And God had to change the way Peter thought so that he could reach more people. And we're going to read about it right here, okay? So Acts chapter 10, verse 9. It says, the next day as they went on their journey and drew near the city, Peter went up to the housetop to pray. What did Peter go up to the housetop to do? Why was he praying? Wasn't he already spiritual? That's where he got his lifeblood from. That's where his life hung out. So he says he had some downtime. It says, then he became very hungry and he wanted to eat. But while it was being made ready, he fell into a trance. He saw heaven open and an object like a great sheet bound the four corners descending to him and let down the earth. In it were all kinds of four-footed animals of the earth, wild beasts and creeping things, birds of the air. And the voice came to him and says, rise, Peter, kill and eat. But Peter said, no, Lord, for I have never eaten anything common or unclean. He was a Jewish person. He followed the Jewish law, and there were certain rules for them to do. They couldn't go certain places, couldn't hang out with certain people. They wouldn't eat certain foods, and he stuck to that law. And God was changing his thinking right at that moment. Verse 15, and the voice spoke to him again the second time. What God has cleansed, you must not call common. This was done three times, and the object was taken into heaven. So this opportunity happened in prayer. This change in his thinking happened in prayer. And Peter was a smart man. Peter was a man of God. Peter was the rock God was going to build his church. And God had to use a moment of prayer to change his thinking. What do you think God could use in a moment of prayer with you? It would be in that prayer time that God would be like, hey, by the way, you've been doing this. Hey, by the way, this is the way you've been thinking about this. You need to change this. And God will show you things. He's the revealer. And then you walk out of prayer super smart. I say it this way. God makes stupid people look really smart. That should encourage some of you in here. You're like, hey, I'm going to be all right. God will help some of us, me included, who are a little slower than the rest. He'll catch us up in prayer. And guys, you cannot get this through a book. You cannot get this through just a self-help program. This is God. He brings revelation. You're like, I'm like, oh my goodness. You just fall out in your own wisdom. Keep going. Verse 17. It says, now while Peter wondered about the vision within himself, which he had seen, meant, behold, men who had sent from Cornelius had made an inquiry from Simon's house and stood before the gate. They called and asked whether Simon, whose surname was Peter, was lodging there. And basically, to make a long story short, these guys came and they were looking for Peter. So look what God said to Peter. Verse 20, it says, arise, therefore, go down and go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them. Verse 21, then Peter went down and he met these guys and he invited them in to stay the night. Catching us up to verse 24, says, the following day, they entered Caesarea. Now Cornelius was waiting for them. This man who had sent guys and sent these guys to go find Peter. This guy, his name is Cornelius. He was waiting for Peter. And Cornelius, he had called together his relatives and close friends. As Peter was coming in, Cornelius met him and fell down on his feet and worshiped him. But Peter lifted him up, saying, stand up, I myself am also a man. And he talked with him, and he went in, and he found many. I circled many in my own Bible. He found many who had come together. I love this because God used Peter for this moment, and all of a sudden, he's standing at a platform in a place, and he's able to witness and be. That was way better than Peter knocking on doors and passing out tracts, don't you think? Come on, get saved. You're going to hell. You know, like it was a better system than Peter could have ever done by himself. God orchestrated this whole thing without Peter's help. All Peter had to do was just pray and get some instruction and, okay, this is what you're going to need. All right, I'll go. That's how we're supposed to witness. That's how we're supposed to change our world. Listening to what God's telling us to do and go do it. Keep going. So Peter did this and And verse 28, he says, you know that how unlawful it is for a Jewish man to keep company or even go to another nation, but God has shown me that I should not call any man uncommon or unclean. Therefore, I came to the objection as soon as I was sent, for I asked them for the reason which I've been sent for me. So Quirinius basically said, hey, 4 days ago, I was fasting until this hour, and at the ninth hour, I prayed in the house. Behold, a man stood before me in clothing, and Quirinius, your prayer has been heard. Your alms are remembered in the sight of God. Send therefore to Joppa and call Simon here, whose surname is Peter, and he is lodging in this house. So Cornelius, he's not a man of God yet. He's praying to God. He's like, God, I want to see you. And remember, the Bible says that if you seek him, you'll find him. So there, Cornelius is just like, I don't even know how to pray, but I love you. I need you. And he sees this, and God sees that and orchestrates, brings an angel and says, hey, send Peter. Peter will preach the gospel to you. And so this is all orchestrated by the Spirit of God. This is Acts. This is the church we're supposed to be. Guys, we don't need any more systems. We don't need any more like advertising campaigns and like, all right, okay, we're gonna dance like this and people will come. I don't know. I have done some like knocking on doors, witnessing to people. It's really hard. Where you like fumble over your words, like, hi, Jesus and Bible and, oh, you're busy? Okay, yeah, so sorry, another day. I'll talk to you later. Okay, bye, good seeing you. Take my flyer. Like, I've done it. It's hard. I'm not saying there's not a place for that, but I am saying that there should be places where the Holy Spirit comes and orchestrates things and people's hearts are ready and knit and you're just at the right place at the right time because you were listening and it was easy and you're like, oh, that was really easy. That was a lot easier than flyers. Like, and it works out. That's how we're supposed to witness. But it takes a church that's alive. Because if we're kind of just dead on the inside, yeah, then we better go get some flyers and try to hit a couple. And guys, I don't know about you. I want to be alive. I want to do this with the help of the Holy Spirit. And guys, some of you guys, this even spiritual talk, you're like, I don't get it, man. Like, listen, this is how we're supposed to live. The Bible says it this way. God will show you things to come. He will lead you. The Bible says that those who are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. Like, this is something that's not talked about too much in churches, but we are to be led by the Spirit of God. God should show us things to come. We should have a knowledge beyond our own knowledge about what we should be doing and what we should not be doing. There should be the Spirit of God on the inside is helping us. Keep going. Verse 44. So Peter ends up preaching the gospel to these people, a whole crowd of people. And I love this story because it just goes to show God's desire for all people. 44, while Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who heard the word. And those who were circumcised, who believed, were astonished, as many who had came with Peter, because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles as well. For they heard them speak in tongues and magnify God. And then Peter answers, says, can anyone forbid water that these should not be baptized and we receive the Holy Spirit just as we have? And Peter began to talk about God and God fell in the place and all these people were blessed and filled with the Holy Spirit. And Peter's like probably just standing back like, whoa, what just happened? And that was God's witnessing campaign. Today, I believe that There might need to, band's gonna come up. Have you been so busy that you've not made allowances for the Holy Spirit in your own life? It's okay to say yes. And actually, I hope we say yes. Some of you, you're in this place and you need to understand that sin, what I mean by sin is anything that hurts your heart. And I mean, I'm amazed at the TV shows that we sometimes engage in if we're not careful. And you got to realize that Netflix is not going to bring you closer to Jesus. It just won't. iTunes top 10 movies will not bring us closer to Jesus. They're not designed to, period. And so there's sometimes in our lives that we have to push things out so that we can get closer to God. And sin will bring you, it'll cool your heart. It'll cool your affections towards God. And I had this scripture specifically for, I believe, this service. This is Acts chapter 3. It was the very first time the Holy Spirit was poured out, essentially, right? And this is Peter. He says, repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sin would be blotted out, so that times of refreshing can come in the presence of the Lord. There's something about repenting. There's something about bringing your heart to like, God, I messed up. I got distracted. God, I've been playing games on you. And there's something about that honest heart that says, hey, and God comes right on the scene. And there's a spirit of refreshing that can come. There's a grace that can come in your life. And there's a brand new vision that can come in your life. And I believe that God is trying to bring more spirit into your life, but it first comes through repentance. It comes through that acknowledging, man, I've been too busy. I've allowed things to creep in. I've allowed my heart to grow cold. It was accidental. And listen, the devil's very smart. He's got us distracted on purpose. He's got us busy on purpose. When was the last time God interrupted your day? When was the last time God interrupted your lunch and like showed you something? So you're like, man, I see that. Forgive me. Oh, you want me to? And listen, if Peter did not have that lunch interruption, he would have never went to Cornelius' house. Listen, there's some things God needs to change some of your thinking so that you go to the people that you would have never thought you would have gone to. Places that you never would have thought that you would have been in. But it came through that prayer time. This has to be priority. The presence of God has to be on our life. Right now, every head bowed, every eye closed, I want to encourage somebody in here. If you're in this place and you've been so busy, you've been wrapped up in life. Maybe you're a Jesus follower, maybe you're not. But you feel like tonight, you're just saying, yeah, I need to repent. I just need to come back. I need to bring my own heart back to this place of following God. And I want that spirit refreshing. I want to be a follower of Jesus again. Every head bowed, every eye closed. On the count of three, one. Come on, God is drawing you. Drop those things. Oh, I see that hand already. Two. Come on. I've been distracted. I see it. I want to know who I'm praying for. On the count of three, shoot your hand up, put it right back down. Three. Right up. Put it up. All right, it's all over this room. Come on. I've been distracted. Just put it up, put it right back down. I just want to know who I'm praying for. Put it up, put it right back down. Father, just these moments as we're putting hands up, Father, I just thank you for this church. I thank you for honesty. Lord, I thank you, Father, for the revelation that we've been too busy. And Father, I pray that you would continue to draw us, that our life would not be one wasting time, but Father, we would redeem the time. We would make the most out of every single opportunity. Lord, that we would be, your spirit would be tangible on our lives, that times of refreshing would come. Lord, we ask you to help us witness with the help of the Holy Spirit. Show us those things that we're to change. Show us those things that we're supposed to drop, let go. Let us not waste time. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. I would like you to stand up with me. We're going to sing a song right now. And I feel like music's a good way to do it, but you can do it at home. We're just going to bring ourselves to this place of saying, hey, I'm not going to waste time anymore. I'm not just going to miss my devotional times and be okay with it. I'm not just going to try to witness on my own. I need God's presence in my life. And I said this, I believe some of us, part of our journey of busyness is the restlessness of not doing what God's called us to do. We fill up our time with other things because we're like a really smart dog that's bored, you know? And that's for the lack, we just get into stuff. We're like, I'm bored and I'm doing stuff. And I don't want to do stuff. I want to do the right stuff. I don't want to just do ministry. I want to do the right ministry. I don't want to just set churches up. I want to put them in the right places at the right time. We need God to do life. And so if that's you, you know, if you're in this place, you're like, yeah, that's me, man. I've been too busy. Okay, we're just going to take 5 minutes and we're going to sing this song, and then I'll come up. We'll dismiss. We'll be on our way and go eat that pot roast that we're cooking, right? Does anybody cook pot roast? No, we go to Panda Express. Okay. So wherever you're going to eat lunch, but we're going to take 5 minutes and can we just stop everything? Step out of traffic, if you may, and put our face to seek God. Just talk to him. If you sing the words, cool. If you don't, just talk to him. And there might be things that he puts on your heart to change. There might be that thing that comes up every single time you pray and it's very annoying and he always tells you to do the same thing. it might come up again. That's it. That's the thing to work on. That's the thing to change. That's the thing. That's the, so you might hear nothing, but regardless, let's just seek God for 5 minutes. Can we do that?
Let's go.